glorious. No, I won't give in, I won't give in till I'm victorious. And I will defend, I will defend.
NXT TakeOver was indeed glorious, as NXT once again gets it right, but the WWE almost had it right and then fucked it up in the end, like they do. I don't know what it is with the Rumble, my favorite pay-per-view, they always seem to fuck it up at the very end. It's not hard to mess up, that is like the easiest pay-per-view to get right, and I like to fuck it up. But congratulations to my favorite and yours, Bobby Roode, on his NXT victory. Clean, yes. NXT victory over Shinsuke, mind you.
Surprisingly clean.
Yes, but that doesn't mean Shinsuke's coming up yet. He might feud with Roode. But damn, was that good.
It was a good
one. Sorry, it wasn't good. It was glorious. So, so glorious. He's come a long way since Beer Money.
Yes, even though I did like James Storm, but I never really saw that tag team together.
That was one of the few NXT things that are not NXT, TNA things that I remember, because I watched it back in the early days, and then I jumped ship because it started to suck. but NXT TakeOver was just really, really good as a show. DIY, dropping the belts to the Office of Pain, was a great tag team match. That's one thing NXT does better than anyone else is tag team wrestling. They tell a great story with the tag teams. The teams are good. I don't know why, when they transition up to the main roster, the WWE fucks them up too. Because, for an example, the Ascension, at the time when they came up, longest running NXT tag champions, and immediately when they come up, the heel announcer, JBL, badmouths them and buries them. And then the Ascension sucks. So, NXT, you're doing a good job down there. TakeOver was awesome.
Yes.
Asuka won, in spite of being outnumbered 3-1, basically. Everyone gunning for her.
Yeah.
I actually thought she was going to drop the belt. I thought this is the
So perfect. Did I. I mean, there's a lot of people. I thought they were going to Bird Rule
I thought
with those
two girls. Billie Kay and... Oh, I can't think of the other girl's name right now. Even though I thought that would be a good way for Asuka to drop the belt, I did say to you before the match went on that they're setting her up for Ember Moon, I think. She'll drop the belt to Ember Moon, probably take over Orlando, and maybe we'll see Asuka up on Raw the next day.
Her contact lenses are so distracting and very creepy. I don't know how she could wrestle on those.
But
she has
even though
to.
She didn't wrestle on TakeOver and you hadn't seen her wrestle, I showed you her finisher, and that is ridiculously awesome.
I wouldn't want to take that finisher.
No. Bravo to all the women who have taken that finisher.
Yeah.
So, NXT TakeOver was great, but let's move on to the Rumble, because we mostly do WWE things here since we film it on Wednesday before NXT... Wednesday nights. But the Rumble overall was good. I would say 90% of the show was great.
Yeah.
It was great. Cena versus AJ stole the show. Fantastic match.
Great match.
Told a great story. We thought Cena was going to go heel there for a second. Mm-hmm. He had that determined look on his face. Yeah. He was getting mad. He was getting frustrated. But now's not the time to turn Cena heel. The time to turn Cena heel was a while ago. They missed that boat. Now they just got to ride it out.
Yeah, pretty much.
Fantastic match. In a losing effort, AJ still looks strong.
Yeah.
Because he kicked out of an AA, then a super AA, and then it took two AAs to bury him.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean...
There was even an STF in there, if I remember correctly.
Yes, and he hit the calf crusher, too. Yep. I think they did a little reversal thing, where I think it went for the STF, then the calf crusher, then back to the STF.
I like how smoothly they transitioned out of one move to... There was a figure four out of Cena.
Yeah, and that's the thing, and that's where Cena doesn't get the credit from because people want to hate on him so much.
Mm.
He's a damn good wrestler.
Yeah.
Because you can't get those smooth transitions from reversal to reversal like a video game if both guys aren't good.
Oh, yeah.
So,
Actually, as Wade Keller put it, if you're still not giving Cena his due after seeing that match, you're really just not being fair to Cena at all.
If you're not giving Cena his due after the first three AJ matches, if you're not giving Cena his due... His matches with Brock.
I started giving his due after the CM Punk match at Money in the Bank.
Yeah.
Because I personally hold that match up there.
I was about to say it was like 5 or 6 years ago when I was starting to give Cena his credit. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I hold the
match. And I was an original Cena hater. I couldn't stand the Thugonomics gimmicks. I did not like it. And see, where everyone else was liking Cena at the time. See, it's kind of funny. I'm opposite. Because I didn't like Cena when everybody liked him. Mm-hmm. And now that everybody hates him, I like him. Mostly because I had to earn the respect. But it was mostly... Yeah. Even though I really liked the Thugonomics gimmick, I thought it was so stupid, and I could not get behind that. I was like, this is just the dumbest shit ever.
See, I got bored with it after they kind of just, like, went away from Edge as his main rival.
By the way, that's a lovely Sting shirt you got on there. Where'd you get that?
I got it from this awesome dude down at WrestleMania.
Cheap plug. but yeah, AJ and Cena stole the show. We're not covering every match, so we're going to focus more on the actual Rumble itself. But the club finally won the belt. That was the only match I got wrong of the night. You got that one right. But I still won. Because I only got one wrong.
Which is why I hate Cena now.
I don't know why I thought AJ was going to win that match.
I want him to go in as champion to Mania. That's what I want. But yeah. I know I have one more pay-per-view for that to happen.
It ain't going to happen because Bray's winning at the Chamber. We'll talk more about that at the end. Yeah. But the club got the belts, which also led to a funny moment in the Rumble with Sheamus trying to eliminate Cesaro after Cesaro decided to big swing everybody.
Yeah.
I really hope we're not seeing the end of Sheamus and Cesaro. I love those two together.
Yeah.
I like funny, too, because the WWE had nothing to do with those guys. Then they had that best of seven match, and everybody and their mother was like, really? We got to watch a best of seven of these jackasses? And no one cared. And then that ended up stealing the show for a while. And then them as a tag team is great because they're like the odd couple.
Yeah.
It's so it works so well together. But yeah, the club finally won it. Hopefully the WWE continues to book them strong. They need to become monster heel tag teams.
Yeah.
Let Sheamus and Cesaro get their rematch but lose somehow, whether it's by heel tactics or whatever. Mm. And then, even though the tag team division's really weak on Raw, just have the club just run through them. In fact, have the club show up on SmackDown and just run through American Alpha. Not necessarily for the belts. We don't need to combine the belts. No. But just have the club show up NWO style in the crowd. And like, hey, you can't... And have Daniel Bryan or Shane come out. Hey, you can't be here. And they just flash the ticket like Scott Hall and Kevin Nash. And then when America Alpha has their match, which should be against the Fashion Police because they really need to push them.
Yeah.
Just have the club come in and just decimate them. It'd be pretty cool because I do want to start seeing some invasion angles.
I mean,
a little bit on the show.
I feel like that will happen when you get closer to Mania, but I don't know of any inter-brand seeds that were planted yet.
No, like, none. Could have at the Rumble.
They should have actually.
Yeah.
That's nearsighted right there. Come on, WWE.
Yeah, you guys really could have done that. That actually is a good point. Moving on, Bayley lost to a vicious natural selection on the ring. To Charlotte. So her pay-per-view streak continues. I mean, not a surprise there, because we both kind of agree when Bayley wins the belt, it's probably gonna be at Mania.
Yeah,
and then I'm gonna make one of my bold long predictions. Sasha goes heel right around that time, probably right afterwards. Like congratulations to Bayley, then turns on her.
I'd seen something where I can't remember who was saying it, but they were besides you online today that that Sasha would be turning heel fairly soon.
I said it last week first. I know this business. Like the back of me hand. Mm. Speaking of which, just off topic real quick, I was I listened to the Shawn Michaels podcast on Talk Is Jericho, which is pretty good. Which gives me a funny thing. You know our before and after movie reviews, we got to find where Gavin Stone's playing. Mm. Take my mother to it because she likes those kind of movies, secular movies.
Yeah.
And we'll do a before and after with her because for some reason YouTube loves when you get your mother doing things that she wouldn't normally do. So I'll take my mom to see a Shawn Michaels movie. But that's just an aside, something to look forward to if it's playing anywhere around us. I gotta see if it's playing.
You could mess with her and be like, it's a wrestling movie.
No, I already showed her the trailer.
Okay.
So that wouldn't work. So Bayley lost, Charlotte continues her streak, no surprise there. Neville won, not a surprise there. Wait, did you pick Rich or did we both go with Neville?
We think we both went with Neville.
We did. And Neville is just awesome. I love Neville as a heel. Because I really didn't care about Neville before this heel turn. Mm-hmm. So he's just there. He did cool moves. And I was like, cool. He's got big ears and didn't expect that accent coming out of his mouth.
no, not at all. But I thought he was taller until he got called up.
He's like Wade Barrett, but being booked properly.
Yeah.
He actually does remind me a lot of Wade Barrett. Like last night at his coronation on Raw, or not last night, Monday night, his coronation on Raw. That was really good. I enjoyed that a lot. And then him and Rich Swann actually might have a decent feud. We might actually have a feud that carries past two matches in the cruiserweight division, which will be good.
They need something compelling.
Yeah. But now we're going to move on to the Rumble. And it was really good up to number 30. But we'll get to that in a second. Some great spots. I think Jack Gallagher stole the Rumble.
Cameraman effed up the spot with the umbrella with Jericho. Because he caught the side, and you could see Jericho spinning the umbrella.
Mm.
So bad form, cameraman. Bad form.
Nah, it's not the cameraman's fault.
It was just
That's Kevin Dunn's fault. He should be directing the camera.
The switching was not good.
Come on, Kevin. Did your big teeth get in your way? I'm pulling that out of Ross's playbook. King Ross. God, he is vicious to Kevin Dunn. Byron Saxton and JBL. But yeah, that whole umbrella spot was great. And then when he got eliminated a la like Mary Poppins style and floated down with the umbrella.
that was great.
Especially that added on to, remember when we were at Tribute for the Troops, that six-man cruiserweight tag, where he went for his high spot, he ran off the ropes, he stopped, crawled under the ropes, and then just a regular axe, axe handle down. Oh,
that
man.
That was fantastic. Oh.
So that
More
was,
from Jack Gallagher.
That was great. Jericho became the 61-minute man. setting the new record for most time in the Rumble, which I think was nearly at just shy of 5 hours, right? It was like 4 hours and 56 minutes, something like that.
Hours and some change.
Yeah, so like congratulations to Chris Jericho, though. He still deserves a Rumble win. I was really hoping he'd get that win.
Especially when he was in the final four.
Yeah, but the only problem is they're taking the belt off of Kevin Owens. Yeah. Which we'll get into that, too, in a little bit. Jericho did a great job hiding and staying hidden. That was hilarious.
I heard part of it might have been because he might have gotten a Charlie horse from, I think it was Baron Corbin Braun Strowman. Like he took like a weird bump in the corner, and it looked like he was that was actual pain.
See, I think,
and he was at, like ringside rubbing it out. Well,
see,
I think
someone asked Jericho that on Twitter, and I can't remember what he said, if he was actually hurt or not, but either way, it worked.
It still fit into his character.
And, fits his character great that he would, like, feign an injury either way and just kind of stab things. Sami Zayn had a strong showing.
Yes.
Braun Strowman had a great showing. I was disappointed that he got eliminated beforehand.
That was very disappointing, man.
But damn, was that a clothesline from Baron Corbin. I know you hate Baron Corbin. You gotta respect that clothesline, though.
I'll give him the clothesline.
I bet you JBL went from 6 to midnight when he saw that clothesline.
6 to midnight, then back to 6.
Yeah, but
a very wet 6.
I think it was you and I talking about this, where Stone Cold had said to the Big Show when he first got in there, "You're a giant. Don't sell." And, or maybe I heard Austin say this. I can't remember.
Mm.
But Austin's kind of like saying the same thing about Baron Corbin, that he shouldn't be selling.
Mm.
That he should literally, like, he's like the one guy on the roster who shouldn't be selling. Mm. That's a mainstay. That's not Brock Lesnar or Goldberg. And I agree with that. Like, Braun Strowman, they're booking him as a monster. He shouldn't be selling. He should be be destroying people. And when they hit him with a finisher, just pop back up and destroy him some more.
Exactly.
Because that will make it, whoever actually beats him one-on-one, and goddamn it, if it's Reigns, I'm going to be pissed. It'll make that even more special for that. Because, hey, this is the guy who, like, he sold against. Braun Strowman, of course, eliminated people. I really wanted him to break Roman Reigns' single elimination.
Oh, yeah.
Rumble elimination record.
Yeah.
Was that 12th?
Yeah, 12, because it would have been 13 to break it.
Yeah, I felt he should have eliminated 13 people. Maybe next year. Because next year it won't have Brock, next year it won't have Goldberg, next year it won't have The Undertaker.
Mm-hmm.
So those are three guys that will be replaced that Braun can eliminate too.
Well, I mean, they could possibly have Brock, but more than likely Goldberg is not going to be there.
Goldberg, I'm making another bold prediction. Goldberg's last match is Mania. He's going to go out in Mania.
I can see that.
He's going to go out at Mania and be in the Hall of Fame next year. That's my prediction.
Yeah, I could really see that. Honestly, at his age, I personally wouldn't want to be doing this forever. Especially, I mean, granted, he's, you know, in phenomenal shape for someone who's in his 50s.
He's in phenomenal shape for someone our age. He's in phenomenal shape.
Yeah, he's just in phenomenal shape. He's not in the shape that he was.
No, because when you get to a certain age, you can't be as bulky anymore. You got to slim down.
Yeah.
But let's get on to the number 30 entrance. Dear God. This is like, I've been watching reactions. There was people yelling and screaming. People on Twitter, they're going to cancel their WWE subscription.
So the normal reaction.
Yeah, my son's was great. He just started crying and yelled, "I hate Roman Reigns," because he really wanted it to be Finn Balor, which I think a lot of people did. And I had to
Even Samoa Joe. Yeah, he wanted or Kurt to be Angle. Joe. There are a few choices that he wanted, but that everyone wanted to be number 30.
Because here's the thing about Roman coming out at 30. Couple things, which is, it's stupid. We had, with the exception of Ty Dillinger, which was a surprise that wasn't a surprise because we all kind of expected it.
Yeah.
There were no surprises in that Rumble. So we were expecting, okay, no surprise entries, no Kevin Nash, no Diamond Dallas Page.
No Booker T.
Yeah, no Booker T. No JBL coming up. I love it when JBL's in the Rumble. His music plays, just puts his hat down, he gets in the ring. No surprises. So that was building us up. It's like, okay, we're at 30 now. It's going to be a big surprise. It's going to be awesome.
It was a big surprise, all right.
And then Roman Reigns' music hits. And I think my favorite reaction, because the next day I watched, well, it wasn't live then, but it was Steven Larson's going in Raw live stream of the event. And they're all like, who's it going to be? Who's it going to be? And then Roman Reigns' music hits. And the air gets sucked out of the room because they don't even like yell or scream. They're just, oh. And it was just like just a sigh, and just, which would, if my son wasn't sitting next to me, probably would have been my reaction to it. Just like, just suck the, just entire the momentum, the air out of the Rumble. And I figured the WWE did it for two reasons. One was the setup of the long setup for Taker Reigns at Mania, which is a dumb idea because both those guys need someone to elevate their game at this point, because Roman is good when he's with good people. Taker's just old and he can't be good anymore unless he's got somebody in there who can do most of the work.
Yeah,
so that's gonna be an interesting
match. Why it needs to be AJ Styles.
And also a heel turn for Roman, because one of the first things he did was eliminate Taker. So I mean, you think, oh, that's a heel move.
Especially with the facial expressions that he was
making. Yeah, he's like,
I mean,
mean.
He was doing his best. He was just booked really
badly. Yeah, once again, he's booked badly. But he didn't really come out as a heel on Raw, which we'll get to when we talk about Raw. But I think the main reason why Roman Reigns was in the Rumble was so that we would not boo Randy Orton when he won. Because let's face it, it came down to Bray, Randy, Jericho, and Roman.
And I would have been disappointed without that caveat. I definitely would have.
And that's the thing, it's like,
I don't know if I had a boo.
Let's switch out Roman with Joe, okay? Mm-hmm. Samoa Joe. And Randy Orton wins. Boos, okay?
Yeah.
In fact, one of my favorite tweets at that moment in the Final Four was from Chad Dukes, a local sports radio host here. Chad Dukes versus the World. And you can check it. He's got a wrestling podcast. It's Dukes Wrestling, something like that. I don't know. Just search it and you'll find it. It's pretty good. He tweeted out, if there was ever a time for you to become a Bray Wyatt fan, now is that time. And I really thought at that point, if Roman didn't win, and back of my mind was like, Roman could win this, and I just...
No, I immediately shut down as soon as he came out. I'm like, oh my God, he's going to win this.
Yeah,
ruined the last 10 minutes of the Rumble.
I'm not a childish person to say I'm canceling a subscription. I wouldn't like tweet about that, but had Roman won, I would not have the WWE Network until at least WrestleMania. I wouldn't care about all the other pay-per-views. In fact, this podcast might have ended. This might have been the last episode. Cause I'm like, because I might have been like, I can't watch wrestling. I just like, I can't do it right now. I'm so disappointed and dejected by Roman Reigns winning that I can't do it.
The Raw ratings dropped to a 1.
Probably lower than that. It's just like, so
SmackDown might spike. I don't know.
So Randy won with cheers because he wasn't Roman. But if Roman wasn't going to win it, it should have been Bray, because it looks like we're getting Bray Randy at WrestleMania.
Mm-hmm.
Or Jericho.
Yeah.
Jericho.
Those were the logical choices.
Yeah, because neither one of them had
won it. Out of who was in there.
Yeah, neither one of them had won it before. And it would have been a nice win for either one of them, because you could have set up the title match for Mania. You have Randy in the Elimination Chamber instead of Bray. Randy wins, and Bray's just like, give me the belt. And Randy's like, no.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that creates the diversion. But what I think they'll do with Chamber is Bray wins the belt, which he's overdue for. And then he tells Randy, go after the Universal title. Randy's like, no, I'm going after the WWE title. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of rehashing the
Batista
Triple H thing. Yeah. But we knew Bray and Randy were going to come to a head at Mania anyways, at least for the belt. It raises up the match and makes it bigger. I still wish Bray would have won the Rumble, though. So that was the Rumble. Like I said, up until we got the number 30 entry, it was a really good Rumble. I was really enjoying myself.
Oh, yeah. I was really enjoying myself.
It just cracks me up how NXT, the takeovers the night before, or if it's WrestleMania 2 nights before, seem to get every beat right. Like, I've never walked away from a takeover thinking, oh, I wish they would have done this.
Yeah.
You know, I've never had that experience at from a takeover. I've never, like, felt...
I've gone to sleep very satisfied.
Yeah, I've never felt, like, gypped or ripped off or played a fool. Or the WWE just constantly does that because we're at the whims of a 70-year-old man. And sometimes he's senile. But also what we missed about when we were just doing the brief takeover thing... was Seth Rollins coming out and just ripping into Triple H. That was great.
That which was also probably my favorite spot.
Part of me also, because of that, because Seth Rollins was banned from the Alamo Dome, part of me thought that Triple H would come out number 30.
Yeah.
And then Rollins would come out of the crowd, toss his ass over.
I could have dealt with that too.
Feud. Yeah, I mean, there's so many things that would have worked better than Roman Reigns, which is why
doing him a disservice.
Yeah, which is why I think Roman Reigns was number 30. So that we wouldn't boo Randy when he won.
Mm-hmm.
Because also, if you think about it, why did Roman get a spot in the Rumble, not AJ?
Exactly, yeah.
So
that was just really, really odd.
Yeah, so it's weird. But let's move on to Raw, because we got an hour to recap everything, and we're definitely going too much on the Rumble.
Yeah.
So Raw was pretty good. This was one of the first, one of the few Raws I actually thought was better than SmackDown. We started the show with Jericho versus Sammy, which was a fantastic match.
Oh, yeah. Always
Sammy came out on top.
Yep.
Jericho was out there without Kevin Owens, which would lead to later when Braun took on Kevin Owens. Jericho was like, you weren't out there for my match with Sammy earlier. Why should I be out there for yours? But we'll get to that more. Yeah. So that was a great match. Good work by both of them. I hope to see a Sammy versus Y2J feud, and Sammy takes the U.S. title off of Jericho. Because I don't think Jericho and Kevin Owens' match at Mania is going to be for a belt. I think it's just going to be those two without belts.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just going to get over it. Because I think when Kevin loses his belt, he's going to partially blame Jericho and so on. And that's going to be their feud. Mm-hmm. Then we had a 6-person mixed tag. Bayley got a revenge on Charlotte. She came out with Sheamus and Cesaro, which was great seeing Cesaro get all into it. He was wearing the Bayley streamers.
Yeah, that
playing with
the
flailing guys. And you can just see it on Sheamus' face when they do shit like that. When he's like, have to be all serious. The
straight
man.
He's trying not to laugh.
He's trying not to laugh and have fun because he wants to have fun because... Sheamus is a cool dude. I got to meet Sheamus with my son. We talked about this when we talked about the tribute for the troops. Like, Sean so badly wanted to go meet the superstars while they were eating. I was like, no, you got to leave them alone. And kind of like slyly walked by to go get another drink and walked by. And Sheamus was like, how's it going, fella? Gave him a huge high five because Sheamus saw him staring at him. But Sheamus is a cool dude. He's pretty funny. Like, I've seen like behind the scenes footage from Ninja Turtles and just like backstage stuff in the WWE. He seems like a cool, funny guy. So
yeah.
You know he wants to have fun. You know he doesn't want to be the straight man anymore. So maybe eventually with that tag team, he'll get to have some fun. Because he's just like, you can
yeah,
just
that's
see
actually
it
what I
his...
liked. That's what I liked about Sheamus' face run. Because like you could tell that he was legitimately having fun.
Yeah.
And he just seemed, like you saw glimpses of the real person.
Like where his character can get boring from sometimes, Sheamus enjoys what he does. And that's one thing I like about this current crop of WWE generations. For like the last, I don't know, 10, 15 years, it's been a bunch of guys who like wrestling. They grew up watching wrestling. They love wrestling. Where a lot of wrestlers in the 90s and the Attitude Era and stuff like that, there were a lot of guys who weren't really into wrestling. Goldberg wasn't into wrestling. Just something for him to do after the NFL.
Brock wasn't into wrestling.
Brock wasn't into wrestling. Something for him to do because he got out of college. I mean, even Kevin Nash, when he started wrestling, wasn't into wrestling. Like, a lot of those guys... And some grew to love the business. Like, let's face it, Brock Lesnar, I don't know how much he loves the business, but he knows how the business works. Like,
and
how he got eliminated from the Rumble really quickly.
Good at it.
Yeah, I mean, he knows how to make money in the business, and he knows when to sell, and he knows when not to sell. I mean, granted, he kind of fucked over Dean last year, which, going back to the Rumble, that suplex on Dean looked extra nasty. Or that elimination I made on
you
Dean.
Talking shit about me? Yeah, ah!
That toss up. But, I mean, when Brock is properly motivated, he's a good worker. He's got to be properly motivated, which he wasn't at last year's WrestleMania.
I definitely smiled a bit at the German suplex to Rusev that he threw out there. I'm like, America!
Yeah.
Talk about someone who kind of got shafted in the Rumble, though. But then again, his nose was, his face was broken.
Yeah. Hopefully Rusev can get some time off.
Yeah.
His and Enzo's feud is going nowhere. They could just kill that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I did love Enzo's elimination.
Enzo was great. I loved it. I love the fact that he went in talking mad shit, and he was willing to back it up, even though he got decimated.
Yeah, because that's basically you going against Brock Lesnar.
Yep.
He got tossed.
I will be willing to back my trash talk up. Yeah, I will get destroyed.
That was so funny. Moving on, Braun got his title shot, which was a nice callback for the WWE, and this is things they need to do, is basically like when they say something in the past and they come back to it. Like, it was like 2 months ago,
mm-hmm,
when Kevin Owens was like, if you help me out, you get your next in line for the title. And Braun called back to it, and they showed the footage.
Oh, yeah.
Because what that does is it makes it feel like I can't miss an episode, because if I miss this episode, something might happen, and I'll be lost in the story next week. Which isn't always the case with wrestling, but it's nice when they do that periodically, yeah, because then it does make it seem like must-watch TV.
Oh, yeah.
That if I miss something, I'm going to regret it. Which is rarely the case, even though a lot of times I'll go to bed at like 10:30. And because I'll just watch it the next night.
Or in my case, I'll fall asleep right in the middle of Bailey's match. Because I was exhausted.
But I did like what Kevin Owens did. I like what Braun did first off to keep Jericho out of the match. He just came up, powerbombed him through the table. Or chokeslam him, I can't
remember. That was great.
Put him through the table.
I thought it was a powerbomb, but I don't quite
remember. It might have been a powerbomb. I can't remember. He put him through the table.
Because I did go back in the morning and watch the clips.
And then at first Kevin Owens was running away, and then he faced off with them. They were having a pretty decent match. It was looking pretty good. And then Roman came out. Now, I get why Roman came out, because Braun cost
him. It made sense.
The night before at the Rumble, which we didn't really talk about, but other than Kevin Owens building his chair pyramid, I wasn't really... 301. Suspected spam caller. Let that go to voicemail.
It's Roman Reigns. He heard you were talking shit.
Bring it, Roman. Leave the vest at home, though, because I don't need no vest.
What are you, D'Lo Brown?
I know, right? D'Lo needed that vest.
Talking about the real deal now.
Yeah, exactly. So Roman came out and exacted his revenge on Braun, which I was disappointed in, because I was really hoping that Roman was doing his heel turn the night before, but he's going to go against Braun at the next pay-per-view, Fastlane. Fastlane, we kept calling it Roadblock, it's Fastlane.
Yeah.
He's going to go against him the next pay-per-view, and goddamn, if he beats Braun... Especially if he beats him clean. I'm going to be pissed. Because then we just wasted Braun's buildup.
Yeah, Roman, exactly.
Roman rarely sells, and he's been built as a Superman. He's not the guy to beat Braun. The guy to beat Braun cleanly is... Shit, I got to turn off the heater. Damn it. Forgot to turn that off. Sorry, folks. We can edit that part out if you want, Nelson.
We'll leave it in.
Yeah, we'll leave it in. Whatever. We're a fly-by-night operation.
The most professional of operations.
I know, right?
Plus, it doesn't really pick up that much.
Yeah. The person to eliminate, or not to eliminate, the person to beat Braun needs to be a David versus Goliath thing. I think it should be Sami Zayn. But if it's not Sami Zayn, have it be like Finn Balor. Because even though, you know, Finn Balor's a tough guy, we haven't seen much of him.
Yeah.
In the WWE. So him, when he comes back, being the first person to beat Braun, that's something special, yeah. You know? But use it to build somebody up, or when, like, Nakamura first comes up.
Hmm.
You know, use it, Bobby Roode
when he comes up. I would like it to be the Demon.
Austin Aries, you know? Yeah, You know, I would like him to have a match with Braun as regular Finn Balor, lose, and then the next match, he's got to be the Demon to beat him.
Oh, yeah.
Again, definitely. Vince, giving that one to you for free. Because I know you watch this podcast and steal a lot of my ideas. And then you don't listen to my good ones.
Now, if you do run into Linda, you're going to suggest the podcast, aren't you?
If I do run into Linda McMahon on the streets, not the first time. Second time. Once she remembers who I am.
It's like, I don't
and
know.
And I don't get accosted by security.
I feel like I don't know that I'd be ballsy enough to even do it. I just don't.
If I got into a real conversation with her, I would. I wouldn't just say it. I wouldn't blur it out.
But
if I
If you can work it into a conversation.
Found that I have the art of schmoozing Washington higher-ups when I run into them. Linda McMahon might be a different story because...
You might fanboy out.
I might fanboy out because when I meet, like, congressmen and secretaries of... Not state. I've never met a secretary of state. But secretaries of different departments.
Yeah.
I don't give a shit who they are. Mm. It's like, I'm not disrespectful in any way, but to me, it's like, you're a government appointee. What have you done? Mm. But like, I know and respect Linda McMahon, so I'd probably fanboy out a little. But Braun, well, technically Braun won because Roman attacked him first, so Kevin got disqualified, so Braun keeps that win over there. I didn't like how Roman Reigns dismantled both of them. Roman should kind of beat down at the end of that. Kevin Owens and Braun Strowman should beat the crap out of him. But,
yeah,
again, the WWE poorly booking Roman Reigns, because there's nothing to root for with Roman Reigns, because he just tears through everybody. At least Austin, you know, Austin had the entire corporation going against him. So it's like,
and that was a lot of people.
Yeah, even though Austin would like run through people, at the very end of the night, the numbers would overcome him, and Vince McMahon would be yelling in his face.
Yeah.
So I mean, it was, even though Austin was kind of, it was like Goliath versus Goliath. It was like Goliath, this Goliath versus this Goliath of a lot of Goliaths. So I mean, it made it something to root for. And then we had Brock Lesnar come out with his advocate Paul Heyman.
Yes.
And made the challenge for WrestleMania for Goldberg,
which, up until that point, the crowd was hot for that segment, but then once they announced that, everyone had a reaction of, yeah, we know.
Yeah.
We know why you're here.
That's kind of the problem with the 12-month pay-per-views.
Yeah.
Because it used to be, you know, we'd maybe have like one in your house between Rumble and WrestleMania, but it was kind of like you'd expect... the big matches at Mania that would be set at the Rumble, you know, the seeds planted, and they build up on Superstars and Raw. But now we've got, like, two pay-per-views in between. Kind of like, why aren't you fighting now? Why do we have to wait till Mania?
Well, also, we have to deal with the fact that we're dealing with a storyline that's dealing with two part-timers.
Yeah, exactly.
So we're just, like, well, did they even say that if Goldberg was coming?
He'll be there Monday.
Okay.
To answer the challenge.
It's like every other week. It's
and
like...
Goldberg will be at Fastlane, and the word is that Goldberg versus... No. Brock will be at Fastlane, that Brock will beat Kevin Owens for the belt, and him and Goldberg are going to face off for the title at Mania, for the Universal title. That's the word right now. That could change, because one Mania booking may have changed, and we'll get to that in 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Triple H came out, Rollins was coming out after him, and boom! Samoa Joe makes his debut, which I actually think is a better debut than him being in the Rumble.
Yes.
Because him being in the Rumble, you'd feel like he should win. So him not being in the Rumble and making his debut by beating the crap out of Seth Rollins was fantastic. Except Joe went a little overboard, and Seth Rollins' knee is hurt. But I'll tell you one thing.
Have they said anything about the knee outside of that he's been hurt again?
That it's real, it's not a work. Joe's been healing it up by mocking Seth Rollins. It's fantastic. Like, people apparently were tweeting at Joe, blaming him for the injury, and Joe responded back with a gif of Alice from Alice in Wonderland crying.
And well, that's like, the thing. Joe is a great heel. He is a fantastic heel.
And the thing is, you can't blame Joe. I mean,
it happens.
We've seen those. Yeah. Just like you can't blame Seth for Sting's injury or Finn Balor's injury, which I do find it kind of funny that... Rollins got hurt by somebody by an up-and-coming NXTer when the last person here was an up-and-coming NXTer. And Joe and Finn are friends. That's payback, bitch.
Karma.
Yeah. So hopefully Seth is good, because originally the plan for Joe was him and Cena at Mania, but then they moved Joe to Raw because, like I said, Joe needs to be on SmackDown. But they moved Joe to Raw to take Triple H's place to have Joe face Rollins on Triple H's behest. But if Rollins is injured... they might move Samoa Joe down to SmackDown and have him go against Cena. Which, actually, if that happens, have him, like, kick in the cage at the Elimination Chamber a la Kane and beat the shit out of Cena and then leave and then Bray Wyatt
wins. I think if that's the case, I think he should actually kind of... That should be going between both shows. I feel
actually,
like that's,
yeah.
that's what
Joe's
should
a free
happen.
Agent right now. Just Joe just beating everybody up.
Or even if he's just... Okay, even if
you know what, fuck it. Have him come back on the NXT too and beat up people on NXT. Joe's just beating people up.
I was gonna say, like, you could still actually have him on Raw as a Raw superstar, but then just have him go between the shows and then start the
feud
that
way. But you know what
I'm picturing
right now? That South Park thing where they did the show about Russell Crowe and his tugboat, and he just goes around the world picking fights. So now I'm just picturing Joe
in a
peacoat in a tugboat with a little sailor's cap on, going from show to show, picking fights.
It's a good look.
It's a good look. Actually, Joe could pull that off.
He probably could.
That'd actually be a really good look for Samoa Joe.
I feel like I've seen him in a peacoat before.
Probably. I don't know why Samoa Joe has always reminded me of Pluto from the Popeye cartoons.
Pluto? Yeah, Pluto. I remember that guy.
I don't know why, but the first time I saw Samoa Joe, I was like, seen him somewhere.
Well, Cena's...
beating up on a sailor, man.
Cena's kind of Popeye-ish, except he's better proportioned.
Yeah. But, so Joe's made his main roster debut. We'll have to see more what happens. Hopefully Seth isn't... I don't want Seth to miss another Mania.
Oh, my God. I hope it's something minor.
As long as it's not a tear, he should be back for Mania. Yeah. As long as he didn't tear anything. And as long as it's not... Well, if it's a total tear, he's done. If it's a partial tear, like that they can go in and do microscopic surgery, he should be able to make Mania. He probably can't do all the spots he would do, but he should.
Yeah.
But that was Raw, so let's run down SmackDown real quick, because we got a pay-per-view to cover, because that's in 2 weeks, but we're just going to cover the Elimination Chamber part. Cena came out celebrating, 16-time champion. Congratulations, Mr. Cena, for tying that record. Ric Flair, by the way, on cue, was crying backstage congratulating John, because apparently that's what Ric Flair does now. He gets over-emotional.
Yes.
The Wyatts came out to confront Cena. Luke Harper came out to help Cena.
Which was a cool spot.
Yep. And then we had an impromptu tag match. And Cena got RKO'd and beat clean by Randy Orton. So Cena doesn't always bury people. So that's sowing some good seeds right there. Making us look like we're going to see Randy and Cena at Mania for the umpteenth time. Those two fighting each other for the belt. But they're going to pull the swerve on us at the Elimination Chamber. Then we had Dolph Ziggler destroy Kalisto with a nice super kick with Kalisto springboarding. Mm-hmm. And Apollo Crews chasing Ziggler out when Ziggler was trying to rip off Kalisto's mask. Let's get rid of that cliche where a heel tries to rip off a luchador's mask.
It's been done to death.
Yes.
Mainly by Jericho, actually.
But then everybody else copied it.
Yeah.
And then Naomi pinned Alexa again. She had pinned her two nights before at the Rumble, which is a good sign for me because that just means Alexa's going to win at their singles match because Alexa is not going to lose, and then drop the belt.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's what the heel does. They lose, and then they pull it off at the pay-per-view.
Yeah.
So I'm good for that. Keep that belt on Alexa.
Plus, I want to see that feud develop more because I actually like Naomi as a
character. It ain't going to develop more. Naomi's going to get her shot and she's going to lose. And then Becky's going to finish up with Mickey. And then Becky and Alexa at Mania. Calling it right now. Then to close out the night, we had AJ versus Dean. AJ won that. But we did have The Miz and Baron Corbin getting involved. I love The Miz on commentary. Baron, I really wanted Baron to offer more on commentary. He needs more work. I know you hate him. Shut up. Baron Corbin's got the athleticism. He's got the size. He's got the brutality. They just got to work on his promos. And he can be the total package of a monster heel. Shut your mouth. I don't care what you think because you're wrong. But Baron Corbin just needs to work on those promos more.
Like how I don't have to say anything anymore.
No, because we know you're going to say it. All right? Just like on our other podcast, we know you're going to say something disparaging about Power Rangers. So I know you're going to talk shit about Baron Corbin, and you're wrong. But Baron Corbin has all the makings of a monster heel. He also needs to shave his head. Because
that hair is
thinning. You know, shave your head, get the beard out. And he joins the club. He can be Club SmackDown. Him and AJ, Club SmackDown, Club Raw. And they bring over Kenny Omega.
I'll just call them the hair club for men.
Yeah.
The hair club for SmackDown.
Exactly. But AJ's got a fine head of soccer mom hair. But AJ won. Like we didn't figure that coming. Don't know what they're going to do with AJ because they're moving Cena out of the belt area. It's going to be Bray and Randy. I don't think AJ's going to go for the IC title, though I wouldn't mind seeing the strap on him. I think that also would help the prestige of the belt.
Oh, yeah.
But I think they're setting... I don't even know who they're setting up Dean with.
Though I always find it odd once a competitor has gotten like the heavyweight title and then goes back to the IC. It's a weird transition for me. I don't know why.
It isn't when it's The Miz. Just like, get back where you belong.
I feel like it's because of the Attitude Era.
Yeah.
Because it kind of like diminished the prestige of the IC title. I guess that's what it is.
But all they got to do is just establish good upper mid-card feuds that don't have to be for the belt. Because the Attitude Era was really good at that.
Yeah.
Because you just got to make people care about matches that don't involve a title. And SmackDown's a lot better at that than Raw is.
Yes.
For sure.
Yes, definitely.
So I don't know what they're going to do with AJ. I really don't want to see AJ versus Shane. I love Shane McMahon, but I don't want to waste AJ on Shane at all. Like, I can't think of, other than Joe, I don't know who I'd want to see AJ against. Unless Finn Balor's back. That'd be a good match.
I would like to see that.
AJ versus Finn.
as enjoyable as
AJ versus Shinsuke.
Oh yeah, definitely.
A rematch from New Japan.
Yes,
I believe that was AJ's last match in New Japan was against Shinsuke.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah, so that would be a cool Mania match.
That was also on demand for New Japan Pro Wrestling.
Yeah, so that'd be a really cool Mania match. So I don't know what they're doing with AJ. I don't think he's gonna go for the IC belt. I think Dean is going to feud with Baron Corbin for the IC belt after the Elimination Chamber.
I think that would be a good feud for both of them.
Yeah. It'd be a brutal feud, too.
As much as I dislike Baron Corbin, it'd be a good feud for him to have.
You got two guys who just club. They don't really... They're like the Revival, but singles. No flips, just kicks. I'm sorry, no flips, just fists.
Yes.
So that'd be a cool match. But let's touch on the Elimination Chamber. They announced the six today. I don't know if... Yes, the WWE announced it, because that's where I got the list off, because I couldn't find the tweet that I originally saw. It's going to be Cena, Dean, Bray, Miz, AJ, and Baron Corbin. Like I said, everything points to Bray winning this. It'd be really cool if they're going to do Joe Cena. If Joe breaks through the cage and beats the crap out of Cena, which sets up their match.
Is Orton in the Elimination Chamber?
No. It's just six. Orton's the Rumble winner. Why would he need to be in the Elimination
Chamber? Oh, no, because I thought I saw him in the thing, but I wasn't
So, but there we could get the seeds for Baron Corbin and Dean Ambrose to feud.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe AJ and Miz are going to feud. Maybe elevate Miz a little, turn AJ face. So that way, when we have a heel champion, you know, AJ gets the belt back as a face. Let him have a run as a face champion.
The whole roster is hurting for some faces right now.
Yeah, because pretty much right now we got Cena.
And Dean.
Dean's mid-carding again. Yeah. He's upper mid-card, but as far as the upper echelon...
Oh, yeah, on SmackDown. Cena. Yeah, just Cena.
So, maybe that's what happens. Maybe that's what they're going to do with AJ.
Mm.
And I think him and Miz could turn in a pretty good feud, like have them start the feud, lead into Mania, though I feel that would be a step down for AJ from having a great match with Jericho last year to face off at The Miz the next year.
Yeah, that's
and no offense to The Miz at all, but you're not Jericho. You might be buddies with Jericho.
Mm.
You're not Jericho.
I mean, you've had a hell of a year, and you're on the right track, but for Mania, he's not.
Actually, I would say next to AJ. AJ, for me, is WWE Star of the Year for 2016.
Mm-hmm.
Had a great premiere at the Rumble. Had great matches with Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
Great matches with John Cena. Won the belt
and
carried it into 2017. But The Miz had a hell of a year, too.
He did. Yeah, he definitely had. Yeah, those are both guys that had really great years and really put in a lot of good work.
Yeah, but I don't think AJ Miz, that's a feud for a SmackDown pay-per-view. For Mania, I want to see AJ against a top-tier star.
Mm-hmm.
So, or maybe AJ wins the belt back and we get AJ Orton, because we haven't had AJ and Orton yet either. I don't think that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
But Vince might change his mind at the last second. I'm just trying to think of who I'd like to see AJ
face.
And I don't want to say Joe, because we've seen that before.
Oh, yeah.
Not
I wasn't going to say that.
But we have seen that.
Yeah. That's something down the line. I don't want to see that just yet. But I want to see AJ versus Taker. Because AJ can have a good match with
AJ could carry
anybody.
Taker.
Yeah, he's like one guy that can carry
Taker. I don't want AJ
Taker.
To lose two manias in a row.
That's true.
That's not a good precedent to set.
That's very true. But if this is his last... I was gonna say
Taker deserves to go out on top.
Yeah,
Taker
that's the thing. He's like he does. He deserves to go out on top.
I tell you one thing, man. If Roman Reigns is facing Taker, and if Roman Reigns beats Taker, and he doesn't become a heel, the WWE has left so much money on the table because he's gonna get booed out of the building again.
Yes.
I
think that would ruin his career.
And
that'd
the thing
be
is,
death
I don't get why they're pushing Reigns so much because I think this was going in Raw that I was listening to. His merch sales aren't that good. They're pretty low. So, I mean, if he's not... If he was selling merch, I could get that. Because Cena is at top. Because
for,
Cena
yeah, like 10
is,
years. He's
with the exception of a brief period where Daniel Bryan beat him and a brief period where CM Punk beat him, for like the last 10 years, it's been John Cena merch flying
off the
shelves.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, I don't know why they're pushing Roman so much because I bet you AJ sells more merch. Just looking at our board up there... I imagine Jericho probably sells more merch. KO probably sells more merch.
I think Bray might sell more.
Bray might. Goldberg and Brock probably definitely sell
more merch. Oh, yeah, yeah. So I mean, those are...
I bet you Bayley sells more merch. How many Bayley shirts do we see when we go to events now?
Dude.
So many.
I didn't tell you about this. When I was doing Script DC earlier in the last... Or toward the end of last year, the receptionist at the office that I had to go do rehearsals at, she was wearing a Bayley shirt.
Oh, well, actually, speaking of that, so during the Rumble, funny aside, a friend of mine, she was at this concert with some friends, and she was posting on Snapchat. And one of the first Snapchats was this little girl in a Bayley t-shirt with the single ponytail like Bayley.
Yeah, the side ponytail.
Watching the Rumble on her dad's phone.
Oh.
And her dad was rocking a Finn Balor hoodie. So it was just kind of funny. It's like, Bayley fans are everywhere.
Yeah, exactly.
I would bet Bayley's in the top five of merch sales for the WWE.
Your son's a Bayley fan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just the proof of the new era, how they've respected women's wrestling. My son, who's 8, who thinks girls are icky for the most part, doesn't have a girlfriend, doesn't want one, they're icky. Huge Bayley fan. Because they've respected the women's wrestlers. Like, they're actual wrestlers.
Yeah.
They're not eye candy like they were when we were his age. So.
Yeah, exactly.
I think on that positive, gender positive, topic, I think that's where we're going to end and say good night and have a glorious evening, because Bobby Roode is your NXT champion.
I'm a hugger.